Welcome, everyone, to Resources for the Future. Good afternoon. I'm Richard Newell. I'm the president of Resources for the Future. I want to welcome you to our Policy Leadership Forum, featuring Dr. Hoesung Lee, chair of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, or the IPCC. We're very pleased to have Dr. Lee here. He's the first economist to chair the IPCC, and his interests encompass the economics of climate change, energy, and sustainable development. He's the endowed chair professor at Korea University Graduate School of Energy and the Environment in Seoul, Korea. And he has a long and illustrious career in energy and climate economics. In addition to his many contributions at the IPCC, he served as the first head of the Korea Energy Economic Institute, and he's also led the Korea Resource Economics Association, as well as the International Association for Energy Economics, among many other contributions which are highlighted in his biography that you have at your seats. Many of you are familiar with Resources for the Future, or RFF, but in case you're not, our mission is to improve energy, environmental, and natural resource decisions through impartial economic research and policy engagement. Dr. Lee has emphasized the importance of the IPCC, focusing on opportunities and solutions to the climate challenge, in addition to its vital work in furthering the understanding of the state of climate science. This is something that obviously resonates with us at Resources for the Future, and our commitment to finding cost-effective and practical approaches to climate mitigation and strengthening climate resilience. We have two major and related initiatives underway on this topic currently, one on carbon pricing policies, such as cap and trade or a carbon tax, and a second on improving estimates of the social cost of carbon. There's more information on these initiatives at your seats or for those online on our website. Before we hear from Dr. Lee, a few logistical notes. You'll notice that one of the other items placed at your chair is a small card, which is for you to submit questions. A staff member will collect those questions during Hoesung Lee's remarks, and then we'll try to get to as many of those as we can during the Q&A session, which we will have up here. Those of you watching online can submit your questions via Twitter using hashtag AskRFF, that's A-S-K-R-F-F. And one reminder for our discussion today, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change is a scientific body and doesn't comment on the policy choices of individual countries. So Dr. Lee won't be able to respond to questions about recent policy directions in the United States or any other country for that matter. Now, please welcome Dr. Hoesung Lee, chair of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change.
Thank you, Dr. Newell, the president of RFF, for invitation to this forum. I noted that this year is the fifth anniversary of RFF, and I want to convey my best wishes to all of you. In fact, many of us benefited greatly from RFF, the first think tank devoted to natural resources and environmental issues, and clearly the pioneer in the field of environmental and natural resource economics. Many RFF fellows have participated in the IPCC assessment task, and we are very grateful for their intellectual contributions to the IPCC. So I'm very pleased to be here to share with you an overall direction and some specific issues the IPCC plans to address in the current assessment, which is known as the sixth assessment. As Dr. Newell mentioned, we are the science assessment body. Our mandate, which is stipulated in the United Nations General Assembly resolution, to be specific, 4353 in 1988, that endorsed the establishing the IPCC. The mandate is to, I quote, provide scientific assessment of the magnitude, timing, and potential environmental socioeconomic impact of climate change and realistic response strategies, unquote. I want to emphasize this realistic in our mandate. And our first assessment report that was released in 1990 led to the establishing the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, the Climate Treaty, the UNFCCC. The 5 years later, we released the second assessment report that provided the scientific basis for establishing the Kyoto Protocol. Our fourth assessment report in 2007 provided the scientific basis for a 2-degree climate goal agreed in the Copenhagen Conference of Parties of the UNFCCC. And our last assessment, the fifth assessment report in 2014, provided a scientific basis for the Paris Agreement. The current sixth assessment began 2015, in fact, right after the Paris Agreement, 2016, with preparing a special report on the global warming of 1.5 degrees Celsius. This assessment was specifically requested by the Paris Agreement in 2015. The parties to the Paris Agreement wanted to be informed of this climate impacts of 1.5 degree warming and greenhouse gas emissions mitigation pathways compatible with this 1.5 warming before they go to the table for the facilitative dialogue in next year. Now this dialogue, facilitative dialogue, will be a prelude to the first global stocktake in 2023 where the parties to the Paris Agreement will review the progress of climate actions toward the climate goal. As you may well remember, there were very little scientific understanding about 1.5 degrees warming during the climate negotiations in 2015. But nonetheless, the countries decided to take precautionary approach by agreeing to pursue this 1.5 degree warming, and also at the same time decided to invite the IPCC to conduct a special report on the warming of 1.5 degrees Celsius. They wanted clearly a science-based implementation of the Paris Agreement. The key topics to be addressed in this special report are mitigation pathways, impacts on natural and human systems, global responses, and sustainable development. We just finished the initial draft, the first order draft, and also that first order draft went through the expert review that completed in September. The second order draft is scheduled to undergo expert and government review early next year. The report will be released in October the next year to support the facilitative dialogue later that year. Like all IPCC products, the drafts is not for public use before the approval next year. So I can tell you specifically what's in the what will be in the special report. In any case, the current draft will be revised in response to review comments we received, and also will be revised the available new literature. I encourage you to participate in the review process, which is a very important process in the production of IPCC assessment. Even if main content, substantive content, may not be available for public, we can draw some useful insight on this 1.5 warming, drawing from the messages, key messages of our last assessment. And as you imagine, the Paris Agreement and IPCC, the decision to prepare this special report, stimulated a considerable new research on 1.5 degree warming. Comparing this newly emerging scientific literature regarding 1.5, with a two degree warming, I think should be a very exciting task. I want to remind you that some of the main conclusions of the AR5, specifically with regard to this 2 degree warming, so that you may have some develop some insight about this 1.5 degree warming. I must start with the probability, the 2 in 3 probability of limiting warming to 2 degree Celsius requires that the 2010 global GHG emissions be reduced by 40% through 70% by 2050, and that has to be net zero by end of this century. That is the emissions reduction pathway that would be comparable to the 2 degree warming, and the attending probability will be more than 66%. The emissions reductions on that scale entail a major transformation of the global energy system over the next several decades. Energy efficiency must increase enough to restrain demand growth, and energy carriers need to be decarbonized. Carbon neutral electricity and carbon neutral synthetic fuels. Given the existing energy supply infrastructure and the stock of energy using equipment, these are indeed enormous changes. Emissions trajectories that have the same probability of limiting warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius obviously will call for a earlier, a faster emissions reductions. The vast majority of the 2 degree Celsius scenarios, the available at the time of the AL5, obviously, temporarily exceed the target and are brought back down to 2 degrees C by end of this century by CO2 removals from the atmosphere. Thus, the AL5 implies 1.5 degrees C pathways are likely to overshoot during this century, and this overshoot has numerous implications. Implementing negative emissions technologies, which are required to achieve this 1.5 or 2, will create competition for land with complex consequences for energy, food security, and biodiversity conservation. This will be assessed by this very special report. The scale of the temperature overshoot will affect the impacts of 1.5 degree warming. Ecosystems in temperature-sensitive regions, especially sensitive regions, may face adaptation limits. For example, passing tipping points with irreversible system changes. AR5 indicated that impacts due to the current level of warming, which was at that time at the end of the AR5, which was a 0.85 degree above pre-industrial levels, have been observed on all continents and in all oceans. Species displacements, marine freshwater and terrestrial species, disrupted crop production, forest dieback due to the drought and heat, and damage to some unique ecosystems, notably including the coral reefs and Arctic summer ice. And climate change velocity in a world of 2 degree warming was assessed in the AR5 as being too rapid for many ecosystems to adapt. The special report on 1.5 degree warming will evaluate differences in the impacts due to the reduced climate change velocity of half a degree less warming. Let me mention a few examples of the recent research reportings on the 1.5 studies. These are some of the examples that the IPCC, the special report, will assess. First, on the probability of an extreme temperature event. That study particularly indicated that 1 in 1,000 extreme temperature event, and this report that it is projected to double as warming increases from 1.5 degrees to 2 degrees. Second, on the effect of early mitigation action, the studies report that it reduces the probability of extreme seasonal temperature within 20 years in many regions, indicating that the early mitigation action will produce the benefits in the near term as well as in the longer term. Thus, earlier and more ambitious mitigation action as required by 1.5 degree warming will yield near-term benefits in the form of reduced climate change damage and reduce the risk of temperature overshoot and its associated damages. Third, on understanding of relation between 2 and 1.5 degrees pathways, recent studies report that the mitigation pathways with a 4 in 5 chance of staying below 2 degrees, which is very high, will be compatible with a 1 in 2 chance of 1.5 degree warming. Increasing the level of action for 2 degree goal will improve the likelihood of limiting the warming below 1.5. And thus, the ambitious mitigation action now will increase the chances of attaining climate benefits and reduce the risk of temperature overshoot. This is what the science tells. And this is what some of the literatures that we will assess in the special report 1.5 as well as our main report. The question is how this ambitious near-term action that will materialize. Again, our last assessment provides some very useful insight to this. We found that in most countries, the governments are addressing climate change in the context of other national priorities, such as energy security, poverty alleviation. Improvements to climate policy programs need to engage these broader national priorities. Second, in most countries, we also found that it is not only national governments that are relevant to controlling emissions. Many diverse actors participate in climate policy. And this diversity certainly will facilitate deep cuts in emissions that require transformation in institutions, technologies, consumption patterns, and human behavior. Third, there are profound uncertainties around the socioeconomic factors related to technology development and deployment, economic growth, and governance. There's little basis for taking, at this moment, an optimistic or pessimistic view about the feasibility of a particular temperature goal. What is relevant is to make explicit about assumptions behind mitigation pathways associated with temperature goals and evaluate those assumptions. Fourth, risk management techniques have not spread into wide use in actual mitigation strategies. Implies that we need to improve scientific understanding of how people perceive risk and respond to different kinds of risk. Building on these conclusions and related scientific findings and new literature, the IPCC will assess the state of knowledge relevant to policymakers for implementation of the Paris Agreement. There are 5 reasons why the transition is perceived challenging according to our last assessment. The first is the cost gap between zero carbon technology and hydrocarbon fuels. Now, this cost gap will change as we move into the future period. Second is scalability of zero carbon technology. This is a lot to do with what do we assume about baseline, so-called business as usual baseline. Now, those business as usual baseline really an unknowable variable. The third is infrastructure lock-in. This has a lot to do with path dependence and also the concern about the stranded assets. And fourth factor is very clearly the preference for loss aversion, so-called the status quo bias. And in fact, the investors want to avoid a high front-end expenditure, such as renewable energy, although its life cycle cost is probably less than the hydrocarbon alternative. The last factor was governance element. the more planning and coordination needed to complement the market mechanisms to address the land use change, innovation, behavior, and lifestyle changes. And yet, many mitigation actions have also benefits of enhancing sustainable development, including improving air quality and health. Many models available have somewhat not capturing these benefits adequately. That's the state of art at this moment. Industries for mitigation action also present opportunities for economic growth and jobs. Literature indicates that R&D in renewable energy has a higher spillover effect than its fossil fuel counterparts. Definitely a plus for the economic development. The special report on 1.5 is just one of the three special reports that we conduct in this cycle of assessment. We are planning to produce two other special reports in 2 years' time. The first is the special report on the oceans and cryosphere in a changing climate. And this has direct relations to the Sustainable Development Goal 14, the life below water, and Sustainable Development Goal 2, the food security, and Sustainable Development Goal 11, which is the human settlement. This special report will assess the rapid changes in marine habitats, new knowledge related to sea level risks, and options for increasing coastal resilience in both human and natural systems. The report will also assess ocean as a potential option for negative emissions. Our third special report is on climate change and land use. This has direct implication for the Sustainable Development Goal 15, the life on land. Climate change and land use are closely linked. This report will assess land climate interactions, desertification, land degradation, and food security. A particular interest will be how the deployment of biotechnology, bioenergy, relates to land use and food security, one of the few areas where there may seem to be a conflict between mitigating climate change and sustainable development. In 2021, we will deliver the outcomes of the main assessment, starting with the physical science space, which is known as Working Group 1, the report, and then mitigation of climate change, the Working Group 3 report, and then lastly, the impacts, adaptation, and vulnerability, the Working Group 2 reports. In 2022, the synthesis report will be completed just in good time for the Paris Agreement's first global stocktake the following year. The overall thrust of these main assessment reports, may I say, will consist of four elements. The first is scientific information relevant for global stocktake, which will check progress toward achieving the aim of the Paris Agreement and its long-term goals. The second is finding an integrated flow of emissions, climate outcomes, risks, and development pathways. The third is enhancing the understanding of costs and benefits of mitigation and adaptation in the context of development pathways. And last, providing scientific evidence for finance and means of supporting to strengthen the response and pursue climate resilient pathways. We believe that the result will be a solution-oriented integrated analysis, linking climate futures and socioeconomic development pathways. The result will be policy-relevant science for understanding the link between decision made today and its long-lasting consequences for climate and the economy. Science tells us that actions today to overcome business as usual have positive impact on economic development and climate futures. The IPCC is to support this science-policy interaction, interface, and we'll support you with policy relevant science. Thank you very much for your attention.
Got to take about a 30-second break while we have a little of technical difficulty with the mics. But if any of you have additional questions, please, who's collecting questions? Do I see the person? Christine will collect any questions that you have. So we have those ready for the, she's coming around right now. Christine, I see a hand up here. Somebody's got one. A few, yeah. So thank you so much for those very interesting remarks, giving us an update on where the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change has been and where you're headed. One of the points you've made is that the IPCC has an opportunity to make maybe even a bigger contribution in assessing not only the scientific basis for, you know, the degree of climate change that we're experiencing and what the causes are, but also the potential solutions, so, you know, what we can do about climate change. I was hoping you could say a little bit about, you know, what does that look like in practice, and are there particular things that you imagine that IPCC reports would do that would help improve their value for decision makers?
Solution, thank you for the question, and the solution really means what sort of information can be relevant to decision makers. And the IPCC has long been very keen on the improving knowledge-based knowledge availability at the regional level. So the climate scientists this time around will improve the assessment so that the scientific findings at the regional climate change, information regarding the regional climate change be made available to the decision makers. Now, this regional climate change issues is not really a new issue around this time. It has been on the table for a very long time, but the scientists this time will be able to provide the information differentiating the differentiating the impact on regional climate change from a different emissions scenarios, different and impact from different the impact of different drivers. So that is an improvement from the previous assessment, and also to be useful to decision makers, scientists should also be able to think in a more integral way. For instance, a way to find the synthesizing and integrating the messages, scientific findings of the mitigation and adaptation in a more coherent manner. And that we will pursue this time around. And also, from the specific decision-making perspective, we need to increase our understanding of the linkage between the high-level global climate goals and the sector-level technology information so that the decision makers will have much finer understanding about the opportunities and challenges. And these are the general approaches that the IPCC is trying to improve through the current assessments.
Thank you. Again, from the audience online, hashtag AskRFF if you want to send in a question. Pete, do you have a question for Kristen?
Yeah, we have a question about uncertainty that came in, interestingly. And how do you think the IPCC can do a better job of communicating the uncertainties associated with this question of climate change?
We do have a very elaborate protocol about defining the uncertainty, ranges of uncertainty, and how do we communicate that findings to the policymakers through our assessment reports. We do know, we do understand that we cannot be perfect in conveying the key messages of this uncertainty information, but that's the way where the state of art is. And we wish to give more thought about the importance of the low probability, high consequence impacts. And that's where the policymakers will take a decisive action regarding the disaster risk management, as well as the mitigation of the greenhouse gas emissions. So we constantly want to improve on the communications aspect of the uncertainty implications.
But do I understand right, though, that for now the thinking is that the historic approach to describing confidence and probability associated in terms of likely or highly likely would be consistent with past IPCC practice?
We do have a guidelines, and we will not change the guidelines for this assessment cycle.
One thing that is very of keen interest to us at Resources of the Future and many others, and also something that I know is of interest to the IPCC, is the use of economic models in understanding both the drivers of emissions that lead to climate change, as well as the costs and opportunities for responding to that. What do you see as being some of the key areas where economic models can be improved to help better inform decisions?
I hope that the economic models can be improved in terms of improving the understanding of the mitigation cost. And this mitigation cost so far understood as something that we have to sacrifice. Fine, that's where the current models indicate. But you may know that mitigation cost, as defined as of now, is the difference between the what is known as a baseline, the business as usual, and emissions reduction pathways. And since emissions reduction pathways is given due to the carbon budget, mitigation cost more or less depends upon the level of business as usual that we assume. So we need to, mitigation cost is more or less derived from how we assume the business as usual, the baseline. So we need to get much benefit if economic models can improve on its understanding of the baseline business as usual scenarios, and that will I believe provide a very important information with regard to the mitigation cost, as well as with regard to the benefit of the mitigating activity.
Interesting. Do we have another question from?
Sure, this one came from one of the audience members here. And the question is, are you encouraged by the rapid move to electric vehicles in road transportation? Will it help to achieve the 1.5 degree scenario?
It is very important that it's crucial that the electricity, decarbonized electricity, will be a major energy source for end-use sectors such as energy use in buildings and also energy use for transport sector. Therefore, if the electricity is derived from the zero carbon energy, then electrifying the transport sector will be very good news, and it has to move in that direction. But the key is that electricity has to be a zero carbon electricity.
We've got a couple of questions on the spillover effects of R&D renewables into fossil fuel industry, and also a question about how laying out these climate mitigation paths could inform private investors. So some questions about, you mentioned non-state actors and particularly the business sector.
The spillover effect between the renewables, clean technology, clean energy technologies, and the fossil counterpart is a very important issue. And there has been some recent studies indicating that the spillover from the clean energy is has a higher spillover than the fossil counterpart. And obviously, this is just one or two studies, and IPCC will evaluate, assess those studies along with other studies. And if that is the case, then it clearly has a very powerful impact on the domestic economic development and also on the technology development. It's good news. And the question about the non-state actors, as we all know very well, the climate decisions are being made not only by the national government, but by various levels of subnational entities. And it is very important that at local levels, regional levels, the policy, the actions, and the initiative to reduce greenhouse gas emissions be taken so that the immediate benefits from the so-called co-benefit of mitigation can be reaped by the local community, as well as the local community can do their own disaster risk management in order to cope with the worsening climate situations.
Just to pursue this is in a sense kind of the second question that has come back to this question of the regional and local impacts of climate change and the relevance of science as a necessary input to decisions that aren't just at kind of a nation state level. Could you say a little bit more about that? Is that something that you're seeing kind of an organic demand for that kind of information, or is this more a kind of a natural evolution of the science being able to be more predictive understand impacts at more of a local level or a combination?
Well, the state of the literature at this moment is that it's not quite definitive about the impact of this, the impact of autonomous activity at the local level in terms of reduction of greenhouse gas emissions. And we will assess the emerging literature on precisely that aspect of the impact of non-state actors on the greenhouse gas emission reductions. So, there have been a growing number of cities and regional governments to embark on these mitigation activities and adaptation activities at the local and regional levels. So there must have been some benefits occurring to those actors by taking actions. And many officials in the city governments and also the provincial governments indicate that those actions clearly result in a very clear, tangible local benefits, cleaner air and much better manageability of water resources, for instance, and employees' satisfaction will be much better than otherwise. So they do rely on this local initiative for their own benefits. And I believe one of their own benefit may be the increases in the re-election increases in the possibility of re-elected in the next mayoral or provincial elections. So, okay.
Which I guess speaks to local citizen demand for action on these fronts. Do we have another question?
Yep, a couple of questions have come in related to bioenergy. And in particular, you mentioned a point of conflict, a potential point of conflict exists between bioenergy utilization and our limited land availability. Can you elaborate on that issue, as well as what the science might say about the best way to actually use our limited land resources?
The negative emissions will require a very different kind of utilization of land. And clearly, if technology stays at today's level, then that's the negative emission options will create a very complex interrelation between the energy, food production, and other key resources utilization. But a lot depends upon the productivity changes in the agricultural sector. And we do not really foresee how that agricultural productivity will pan out in the future. And therefore, the scientists at this moment is developing some sort of the scenarios of this productivity, agricultural productivity changes. And depending on the assumption that you want to take, we can see that some scenarios indicate we should not really worry about the trade-off occurring from the competition of the competition for land because of this productivity increase. But again, this is the key factor is agricultural productivity, and we will probably want to see this some further research on the scientific understanding of the factors contributing to the agricultural productivity for the future.
Is this an issue that is getting more attention now with, for example, you have the 1.5 degree report, and the more stringent the scenarios for climate mitigation, the more necessary carbon removal becomes, or things like agriculture or forestry that stores carbon. Is that kind of shining a brighter light on the need to better understand the innovation possibilities there?
Yes, I think so. And especially with regard to the agriculture, current statistics about the greenhouse gas emissions, about 20% of entire greenhouse gas emissions are coming from the agriculture. And even if the energy sector, the 80% of the greenhouse gas emission sources, solves going to the complete decarbonization, this 20% of the greenhouse gas emissions still need to be resolved. And negative emissions in that sense is one of the key options that has to be considered, and along with the productivity of the agricultural sector. And there the innovations and also innovations not only in terms of the technological sense, but innovations also in terms of the arrangements, organization of social institutions. And we need to develop much better understanding about the consumer behavior. If one of the studies indicate, I believe this is a global energy assessment, where it indicates that the energy use in the buildings can be reduced by 50% from current level within the next three decades. Now, if that is the case, then certainly that improvement in the energy use in buildings will due to the improvement in technology and also the adoption of those improved technologies. And if that sort of changes in the consumer demand for energy takes place, then the feasibility questions will probably need to be understood from a very different angle. And innovation clearly plays a very important part, as well as the societal preference, societal attitude toward those innovation is a very important aspect for the encouraging the innovation and technology development.
Yeah, for those of us who've looked at issues of energy efficiency decisions, where you have this really interesting confluence of, you know, technology availability, the role of market design in stimulating action due to financial incentives like energy prices, but also the role of human behavior and trying to understand the evolution of those, you know, innovation systems, human behavior, and policy incentives at the same time can be difficult to unravel. But maybe there's multiple different areas of opportunity. Other question? No.
Yes, we've had a couple of questions about the target of 1.5 and whether that is actually too risky, and should we be trying to shoot for something like 0.5 degrees Celsius?
You mean 1.5 is just too risky and it should shoot for lower than?
Lower than what?
Oh, it's a new, raise the bar, Pete.
Yeah.
The bar,
yeah.
If there is the scientific studies, literature assessing the need for 0.5 degree goal, certainly we will assess such scientific studies. And so far, I must say that I'm not reading every journal in the world, but so far I haven't seen scientific literature proposing for 0.5 warming.
We talked a little bit about the role of different types of policies and technologies. What role do you see for carbon pricing, either in developed economies or emerging economies, as one of the approaches to mitigating greenhouse gas emissions?
The carbon pricing is a, a necessary condition for achieving the climate goals. But it has to be supplemented by technology policies and also other policy initiatives such as some regulatory approaches. Largely because the literature up to the AR5 indicates that there are certain segments of the economy that the carbon pricing alone cannot be sufficient to drive the economy and society into this carbon-free sustainable structure. And as you may know very well, the carbon pricing or carbon tax are highly politically sensitive policy option, and therefore the feasibility in terms of the institutional acceptability and also the societal acceptability is very important. And I believe that the currently many countries are considering these carbon pricing options, but there are not that many who took that option into the realization. Currently about 25 countries adopting the carbon pricing, mostly from developed world. And for developing countries, most of the energy fuels are being subsidized from the public resource, and therefore the reducing energy, reducing subsidy to those energy use may be comparable to the imposing carbon tax. But again, you may imagine that the taking away the subsidy from the incumbent consumers will probably be a very difficult action to take for the political decision makers. So this is where it stands, and carbon price is an important element, and it has to be a part, an important part of the policy portfolio of policy tools.
Well, it's been interesting to see that, a little bit maybe counterintuitive, that one of the consequences of low oil prices globally, at least for some producing nations, has been to look at subsidies more closely. And so there's been some positive momentum there for reasons other than one might expect. Do we have another question?
This came from Twitter, one of our offsite audience members. What emphasis does the IPCC give to translating the difference between 1.5 and 2 degree goals into specific results such as reduced displacement, fewer health impacts, or other tangible outcomes?
Well, those are exactly the specific issues that the authors of the lead authors of the special report 1.5 are working right now. So as I'd like to respond to those questions, that please be patient until October, early October next year, then that we will be able to provide a robust science regarding the impacts on the 1.5 versus 2.0 the degree of warming, and also the emissions reduction pathways compatible with this 1.5 degree warming.
Can you say anything about the path for the sixth assessment report, not the special reports, but the major reports? Is that going to follow a similar structure to past? Has that been kind of the broad outlines of that? Has that been nailed down? Can you share any of that with us?
I briefly mentioned about the importance of regional climate change information, and that's one of the key, theme that the AR6 is going to produce. And there are several other key themes we want to pursue. And for instance, the impact of the short-lived climate forces such as black carbon, its impact has a very high policy relevant implications. So the climate science segment of the IPCC dedicated one specific chapter to deal with this short-lived climate forces. It's just one example. And other chapters are very much also keen on improving the knowledge, scientific knowledge base for the regional climate change information useful to the policymakers, in addition to the usual framework of the working group one chapters for dealing with climate science. In terms of impacts, vulnerability, and adaptation, the focus will be on the integral analysis of the mitigation and adaptation in the context of sustainable development. And this is different from the previous assessments where we much emphasized in a very right way, emphasized the risks and risks of climate change, also the importance of the risk management process and outcomes. But this time around, we want to improve our understanding about this integrated outcomes of the mitigation and adaptation under the context of the sustainable development. For the response strategies, as I mentioned about the realistic approaches to this process, and clearly response strategies has a lot to do with the solution aspect of this climate change issues. And this time around, we want to have we want to provide a very clear scientific understanding about the link between the short-term decision and the long-term consequences. And the climate decisions to achieve 2-degree goal or the aspirational 1.5-degree goal will have to be made right now, not in the 30 years later. And that aspect will have to be clearly conveyed in a very robust scientific way. And also we want to present a much firmer understanding about the global goal in relation to this technology-based sector analysis. And we do have some good understanding of how the global emission reductions pathways will look like to achieve 2 degrees or other emission scenarios, but solution means what those emission reduction pathways specifically mean for technology choice, investment configuration at the sector levels. And we need to develop that understanding this time around.
Following up on the last question, something an issue that's of interest to us at RFF, is there any plan to monetize the benefits from climate action?
It is a very tough area. And in fact, as you may know, the damage function is a very important element in climate analysis. But much further work needs to be done in the damage, improving the understanding of damage function. And we wish to have, if possible, again, to the extent that literature supports, to have the damage function based upon the information on the physical impacts of climate change, and so that it will complement the damage function mostly done so far on a very aggregate fashion. And but again, it is not an easy task to have a very satisfactory damage function. And in addition to identifying the various physical impacts, monetizing those physical impact is another level of difficulty and requires a more robust techniques to have an estimate. And I believe that the fellows and RFF have a lot to do with improving that the scientific understanding of damage function. I look forward to that work.
Yeah, this is referring to our work on the so-called social cost of carbon, which you know, does involve not only understanding the baseline emissions that one is putting policy on top of, but also and the physical impacts, but also monetizing those impacts and discounting them over time, which does add another layer of complexity. One of the things that you mentioned, Dr. Lee, was you know, climate mitigation and adaptation and the role of the IPCC in helping understand that confluence in the context of sustainable development. To what extent is kind of atmospheric carbon removal or even direct climate modification part of the IPCC thinking or assessment now or in the future?
Specifically in the AR6 cycle, the governance and ethics aspect of the solar radiation management will be specifically considered. And in our last assessment, we indicated that economics or technology were not really is a serious matter, but were not really the deciding factor with regard to the solar radiation management. And a lot important element was the ethics with regard to that specific technology, and also the governance matter. And also there's the reason those two elements are important was that we do not know scientifically very much about the full range of impact these climate modification options will generate. So this time around, we first want to give much more specific attention to this ethics and governance matter of solar radiation management, and let's see how the findings of the assessment will come out.
To what extent have kind of biological or mechanical mechanisms for atmospheric carbon removal been part of IPCC assessment?
The technology aspect of this climate modification have been well assessed in the last assessment, and working group one, and this time around, depending upon the literature availability, those assessments will continue to conduct the feasibility or the side effects or other elements that policymakers must consider.
We have a couple of questions about how the IPCC engages with the different groups. One says that underrepresented groups such as indigenous peoples and women have been included in the UNFCCC negotiations, but the IPCC, however, has been criticized for its lack of authors from indigenous groups. Moving forward, do you have plans to address these criticisms? And the second is, how do you engage with scientists who are known as climate skeptics, or at least not on board with the consensus view?
With regard to the group, whether it's indigenous group or other groups, the IPCC consists of 195 governments. They are the decision maker, policy maker of IPCC. And in addition to those decision makers, we do have an observer organizations, and many the research institutions, the universities, and non-state actors can join IPCC as an observer organizations. So the indigenous group, indigenous organization, will certainly, if interested in IPCC activities, I'm sure they are, there is a way for them to express their interest, their participation in IPCC process as an joining IPCC as an observer organization. We do have a number of observer organizations in IPCC. Once being accredited as observer organizations, those representative observer organizations have a right to attend the IPCC plenaries. And the second question is about the
climate skeptics.
Climate skeptics. The IPCC, as Dr. Newell mentioned, is a scientific assessment body, and therefore, any questions about the science related to the climate change impacts or response measures has to be reported in the scientific journal, peer-reviewed journals, and the IPCC will assess those literature along with other literatures. We are policy neutral, we are technology neutral, that we assess what's available in the literature in the various fields of disciplines of the climate-related issues.
Could you say something about the how the process, the consensus process or the peer review process, how does that work at IPCC? Right, so there's some material written and then it's reviewed and then comments are put in and then there's a response to this. So there's a process by which this information is vetted. Could you maybe give us a feel for how that works?
The starting point of the assessment is to convene a scoping meeting. And in the scoping meeting, we prepare a outline for the assessment. And the participants from the scoping meeting are nominated by our member governments and observer organizations, and then chosen by the IPCC working group bureaus. Once outline is presented to the plenary for approval, member governments has to accept, approve the outlines. So all the outlines that I mentioned in my remarks were approved by the 195 member governments. And then the lead authors are selected. Again, those lead authors are nominated by the member governments and the observer organizations, and selected by the working group bureaus. And then the lead authors, chapter by chapter, huddle together and produce the first draft. The first draft are up for review, expert review, and expert review is more or less an open process. You need to declare yourself as an expert, showing your association credentials to the IPCC relevant website, and then the review process begins. This review process is a very, very important process. It is the only way that we control, so should I say, quality of drafts. It's very important. All the review comments, as you know very well, are responded, are addressed by the lead author groups. And for instance, for this 1.5 special report, I mentioned that we finished the review process for this first draft. We received 5,000 comments, and the lead authors would have to deal with every comments, these 5,000 comments, indicating that whether they accept those comments or reject. If they reject, they should write down the reason for the reject. And so in that way, we accommodate all the necessary inputs from the peers of from the peers of this scientific community. With regard to the confidence and consensus process, the lead authors once the findings of the assessment available, then lead authors first look at the whether a quantitative information is available with regard to the specifying the level of likelihood or level of confidence. If that the metrics is available, then that will be the way to indicate the level of confidence. Now, if those quantitative metrics are not available, then the lead authors engage in a qualitative assessment of the level of likelihood, level of confidence. So it is very important that some core critical mass of lead authors be formulated for each chapter so that very informed judgment can be made with regard to the findings of this assessment outcome.
Thank you. Did we have more? And I'm going to ask you, I'm bad as a moderator. I don't have my watch on, and so I'm going to look to you all to keep me on time.
Yep, this is actually our last audience question. We have just a few minutes left. So this is related to the interaction between the IPCC and the broader UNFCCC process. And what role do you see the IPCC and its reports playing in encouraging enhanced ambition by countries over time?
Let me give you an example of how we interact with UNFCCC in the past. When we prepare the last assessment, we did have a so-called structured expert dialogue. The IPCC participated by IPCC the fellows and the parties to the UNFCCC. And it is an open forum, and IPCC presents the ongoing results of the assessment, providing a scientific information to these policymakers. And there are a very in-depth discussion about the implications and ramifications of scientific findings of the IPCC assessments. And there, that structural expert dialogue produced a tangible outcome indicating that the parties need to raise the ambition of climate goals well below 2 degree, 2 degree goal. And in fact, that is one of the items that the expert, the structured expert dialogue produced. And a similar mechanism will be pursued in the upcoming process as IPCC will interact with the policymakers of the UNFCCC regarding the process of the regarding the progress of the scientific understanding of this the assessment. And in fact, as I mentioned in my remarks, the special report 1.5 is to be released October next year, and a month later, the parties to the UNFCCC and Paris Agreement will enter into a facilitative dialogue to check themselves about what kind of progress they made so far with regard to the Paris Agreement. And this 1.5 special study was exactly more or less dedicated to this facilitative dialogue. And then this land and land special report and oceans special report, along with three main report and synthesis report, is all for the global stocktake. There's one more very important report, which is an update, is an update on the methodology report. This methodology report is metrics, dealing with the metrics of the each member governments of the UNFCCC, a report on their emissions and the removals, things of the greenhouse gas emissions. We need to have a common metric, which is, should be transparent and objective, and we do have the last report available, somewhat very old, and this time we are going to update that methodology for report methodology of greenhouse gas inventories, and that report will be available 2019. So this set of assessment reports will be a block of science-based, robust scientific understanding findings that policymakers need to take a look for their informed decisions.
So do I have time for one more question, or are we okay? So one of the topics, it's been an important topic of discussion, is the confidence of the public in science and the role of science in informing decision making. And I was wondering if you'd say, in addition to the process that you outlined that the IPCC follows, is there any thing that the IPCC is doing, or that we more broadly as scientists should be doing to continue to have confidence in the role of science in informing good decisions by our policymakers?
I agree with you, and the formalities that we are taking so far is to improve effectiveness of our outreach activities. And whenever we produce a new outcome of assessment, we engage into outreach events throughout the world, and involving not only the academic community, but also policy making communities in the local areas, and also business communities, so that they will benefit from this IPCC scientific findings. And we try to improve in a number of ways to improve the way we produce the summary for policymakers. The summary for policymakers is the key document that are used by the policymakers. And many times we were criticized that the summary for policymakers were more or less unreadable. And so we decided to engage a communications specialist right from the beginning of assessment process, so that the technical information that the scientists generate can be more or less refined when it comes down to the summary, when it comes up to the summary for policymakers, that the key decision makers can have much easier access, much easier opportunity to grasp the full meaning of the IPCC reports. And we do have a task to carry out. We do have a challenge in communicating our robust findings in much effectively and better fashion to our end users.
Well, I want to just close by thanking you once again, Dr. Hoesung Lee, for participating in a conversation with here today at RFF.
Thank you very much.